Hey Art Family, if you like this one, the full-length version's on Patreon.
They are stupid.
Hello Art Family, and thank you to all the new subscribers. For this demo, I wanted to do a kind of Q&A where I recently posted a call for questions of anyone's questions they might have about traveling with gouache, because I end up answering the same questions over and over again, and I thought it would be fun to just get your questions and then try to put together a video responding to them directly. Before I get to the questions, I thought I would talk a little bit about what I've been using to travel with gouache lately. I recently got a cigar box, Pochade box, from Tad Retz, who's a remarkable painter. He's one of the best I've ever seen. You should check out his stuff if you haven't already. But I use a leather brush roll that he made, and I also use a cigar box Pochade that he sells on his site. And they're super handy. It's a very simple idea. It's just the basics of what you would need. And I just find it to be the most effective and the best box I have personally used. You can fit tubes of paint in the bottom. It has a palette inset in it. When I'm doing a lot of gouache for this demo, I was at a conference, so I was doing a lot of gouache in a short amount of time, and I'm currently teaching gouache at an art school here. So when you're doing a lot, I find it best to try to reuse it, which we'll answer in the questions here in a minute. But I've been carrying this travel palette, which this is just a standard watercolor palette. This is a Spanish palette. At least that's what people call it here, because you can't get it in America. You can only find them in Spain. And I've been using Crescent Illustration boards that I cut down into little panels. That's been my kind of travel kit. We'll get more into the other stuff I use when I get into the questions, so let's get started with that. Okay, so I see your gouache is crumbly where it has dried in its compartment. Does that palette prevent the crumbs from migrating into the adjacent compartments? Is it one that you made? How do you deal with getting the gouache back to creamy consistency for painting? If you spray and wait, do you have to stir it first or what? So far, I'm happiest working with tubes. Curious about your preference. Right, thank you, Carol. So what she's referring to is in the photograph, I have laid my palette out to dry, and gouache, when you let it dry, has a tendency to get very crumbly and kind of fall apart. This is the question I get more than any other question about gouache, which is traveling with gouache and whether or not you should put it in a palette, if it's worth putting it in a palette, or if you should just carry a limited palette of tubes. And I really think it depends on your lifestyle and the amount of time you're going to spend doing gouache. So if you are going to do a whole lot of gouache in a short amount of time, then I definitely recommend using a palette. And this is not one I made. This is a sort of standard watercolor box. I like it because it has really wide wells, but I'm using it right now because I've been doing a lot of traveling with gouache, and I have also been teaching a gouache class, so I use gouache constantly. So it's helpful for me to kind of constantly be able to re-wet the gouache. And it re-wets very simply. If you just spray it a couple minutes before you use it a couple times and then get a toothpick, you can sort of swirl it back into a really nice creamy consistency, which is great. And that works really well for me. I started out with gouache by carrying gouache because some of the people I looked up to who were doing gouache, Pixel P. Chan, Lena Revo, they all use gouache in a little contained box. And so I started out doing that, but it has its pros and cons in the same way that tubes have their own pros and cons. The issue with the box is that it does spill out into each other's compartments, but I have to just keep it level and never let it spill. And the way I combat that is Blick sells this really heavy flat bottomed bag that I carry, and you can get any like a lunch box or anything that has a wide base to it would be fine for carrying it and keeping it from flipping over and tilting. They also sell boxes that have a lid that will seal the top, and that's where the big con comes with using a box like this, where you're storing a lot of gouache is if you get it mixed up and then you seal the lid and put it on your shelf and then have to do a bunch of other stuff. Like for me, I've had to do a lot of watercolor illustration. When I would go back to the box, I would find half the wells were covered in mold and it was like a super gross mess. So I'd have to dig it out and it would waste the whole well anyways. So I do find it helpful if you're going to be doing a lot of gouache to kind of carry it with you in a palette like that, as long as you can keep it from tilting and tipping over into the adjacent wells. I've only had one incident at a con or conference where I was talking to a friend and they accidentally kicked my box over and it spilled out everywhere and that just wasted the box. But other than that, I haven't really ran into any issues other than the mold. But typically when I'm not doing a ton of gouache, my preferred method is to just use it straight from the tube. After a while, you get used to the kind of ratio that you need. Certain colors you need a lot more of. You know, you don't need a whole lot of red, but you'll probably burn through a lot of yellow ochre and blue. So you get used to the sort of ratio and you waste less as you do more practice with it. But also, a lot of people really need to get over wasting the material. So it's easy to get really caught up in not wanting to waste it and not wanting to waste your good paper or ruin it. But you to get good at it, you really got to learn to kind of let yourself go and use what you have. All right, so next, I would like to know your favorite small palette that makes the best mixes, your favorite travel, non-travel brushes, sketchbook or block. So if you're traveling with gouache, I recommend you take a limited palette with you. And probably my favorite limited palette that I use consistently would be yellow ochre, a bright red, so naphthol red in my case, ultramarine blue or cobalt blue, burnt sienna and or burnt umber, ivory black and titanium white. You can pretty much get most of your stuff out of that. I've lately been introducing some extra bright colors because I have a tendency to paint very dull and a lot of grays, and so I've been sort of trying to force myself to use brighter colors by introducing some super fluorescent, like holbein pink and holbein lavender and holbein leaf green, that are very, very bright. And so putting those colors up front, I then have to, it's like trying to play a chess game where some of the pawns have already been moved, and now I have to kind of work my way out of that situation that ends up leaving some sort of speckling and little bits of really bright pops of color, which I've come to really like. But in terms of limited palettes, I would stick to that limited palette I suggested. Maybe add carmine or alizarin crimson if you want a nice dark, rich, cool red. I'm not very particular with brushes because with gouache, it's just whatever gets you painting. So most, even the cheapest brushes are still fine and good quality. And you really, whatever you're going to use that you don't mind beating the heck out of. So I'm more particular about what I use than the brand I use. But I really do like, in terms of the higher end of the synthetic cheaper brushes, is Raphael makes a chiral brush, which is what I'm using in this video, that I really like. I use a 1-inch flat. And I also will sometimes use a 1-inch flat from Utrecht, which is a cheaper brush. And then I also like a round, but I don't even pay attention to the... I think I have a chiral round, but I use about a 4 or a 6 for details. I'm not terribly... I don't care that much about detail, so I usually don't care how small the round is. I prefer to have a still relatively fat round, so you can still focus on the big shapes of the composition. My favorite surface to work on would be Crescent 101 illustration board. I like to cut it down into kind of like panels. If you were, you know, painting oil, you would use panels. But I also really like gouache on some paper too. Arches makes a great hot press block, which is very handy to carry around with you. You could also just buy the hot press sheets and cut them down to size. As long as you're using a thick paper, it doesn't matter. It'll go fine. I like B Paper Super Deluxe Sketchbook is really nice. And I also really like the super heavy multimedia paper from Strathmore that comes toned in either gray or brown. I'll get those in a 9x12 pad and use an X-Acto and a ruler. And I'll cut it in half and take the two halves together and go to Staples or Kinko's or a print shop and have them spiral bind it with plastic or metal. You make some nice thick sketchbooks that way. And for nicer sketchbooks, I really like the Pentalic Water Journal. It's really nice. I've heard great things about Stillman and Byrne, but I have not used them to say if I like them. Alright, so let's see. For a non-supply question, my main issue of drawing or painting anything anywhere outside my house is time. I don't want to start something that I'm unable to finish while I'm out. So, out could be a coffee shop, by myself, or a walk in nature. Do you have any tips for painting in a set amount of time, say under 1 hour or under a half hour when outside? This is a really good question, and of course I think a lot about it myself because I have two very small kids. So leisurely painting a scene is just not in the cards for me in my life right now. So I'm always about speed. The thing about speed is a lot of it comes from confidence and technique. So the more you paint, the more you learn the types of tricks. I don't want to call it a trick, but the technique of negative painting, for example, you learn how you can develop shape and sculpt the painting using negative painting and adjust the drawing and do things like that. So certain parts in the front end, like drawing a detailed picture, become less important, and you can focus on things like the big shapes. And I would say that's the biggest key to working fast outside on location, because that is one of the key elements, is speed. It's a big factor because you're chasing this kind of flicker in time. You know, every 10 minutes or 15 minutes the light completely changes, and after an hour it's a completely different scene altogether. So I like to try to keep my sketches to around an hour and a half. And the main thing is to focus on the value and not the color. Let color be just the garnish to the meal. It's just the, you know, it's the frosting on the cake. It's not your focus. Focus on the most simple shapes you can. So what are the big, broad shapes? And then you can subdivide from there. But if you get those big, you know, 4 to 5 major values working and kind of clicked together, the rest of the details don't matter nearly as much. And over time, you can develop a sense for just how much information you can convey with a minimal amount of brush strokes. You become more concise and faster. I would also recommend using a big brush, a very big brush, because then you can fill areas much faster, and you restrict yourself from getting caught up in the details. Also, and this is crucial, lower your expectation, really, of what you're going to get out of the sketch. If it is a sketch and you have a limited amount of time, just glean something from the moment. That's all that matters. You know, we're not trying to hang everything in a gallery or sell everything. And some things like drafting and drawing don't actually matter nearly as much as you think they do in terms of bringing a person into the scene and into the moment and the mood that you're trying to convey. So the drawing could be way off, the value could be slightly off, you know, those are things you can sort of assess later if it didn't work out. But if you nailed the strong reflected light of, you know, a certain color that's reflected on the side of a building or the bottom of the building or the blue in the shadow, and you've nailed it, then that's a win for the day. Take home the small victories and don't get too caught up in making perfect sketches every time. All right, I'd love to hear your thoughts on using dried gouache. I personally prefer it for portability and less mess, but other artists can't seem to stand it. I like using the dried gouache after you wet it. I find I often just pour tube directly onto already dried gouache, and that's been good for me. Eventually it sort of gets a little less crumbly, that it's not nearly as bad as if you just let it totally chalk out and get turn into a mess. But I do think I've had the best luck with just using a minimal amount from the tubes, but using tubes directly onto a damp paper towel. Let's see. Do you clean your brushes after each use? I rinse them out as best I can, but kind of the benefit of gouache over, say, oil is you can sort of chip out, you know, dried paint and re-wet the brush just fine later on. So I usually try to rinse them out, but I'm not terribly particular about getting it perfect. All right, let's see. Do I have any ways to keep the gouache from drying out? I'm experimenting with tins and damp paper towels, but any insights you have would be helpful. Limited color palettes would also be helpful. I've been using a modified Zorin palette, but am always looking for new combinations. I'm thinking about MacGyvering a brush holder. Also, any sketchbook recommendations? Gouache, even when you're painting indoors, is still a fight to keep wet. I definitely recommend and had the best luck with just putting it directly on a damp paper towel. I don't really have any more suggestions to that because it can also get moldy if you deal with keeping it wet for a long period of time or sealed. So I like it just on a damp paper towel or just to keep spraying with one of those little atomizer sprayers. Those are really handy. I don't spend a lot of time thinking about color, to be honest. It's something I could probably explore more. I know James Gurney has some great videos on choosing a limited palette by taking a color wheel and building a sort of, you know, dotting your pigments on the color wheel and building a kind of triangle or a shape, and then you can see the full range of color, so you can sort of shift it cooler or warmer and generate palettes that way. He has a lot of great information on that, but I don't really explore a lot of different colors. I've been recently introducing some bright colors, but for the most part I stick to my guns on the colors I've been using for years and years and years. The brush roll you may not even need if you're doing gouache, because you could probably just limit the amount of brushes you use. I only use two brushes, but I like to have a roll because if I'm doing watercolor and gouache, having the full range of brushes is kind of handy. But they always have those little bamboo rolls that are pretty cheap and kind of nice. And then there's also the collapsible brushes. I've seen some that come in flats that are really nice. I have some of those too that I've used from time to time. And then you don't have to worry about carrying a roll. And I guess I kind of already answered the sketchbook, but I do think my preferred substrate would be the Crescent Illustration board. I just like the way it sits on it. Okay, so I can't seem to motivate myself to do outdoor painting. When you started out, what few things did you do to make it easier? Also, how long does one outdoor painting take you? I find it difficult to remain calm when scenery changes so quickly. How do you get over the franticness of capturing what interests you? So I didn't start out by painting outdoors. I started out by painting with watercolor, and then I painted outdoors with watercolor for a long time before I tried to do gouache and failed miserably for a long time. It was very difficult for me to learn gouache, and I didn't really get it until I started doing some oil painting and kind of restructured the way I treated it. I think one of the ways that got me going when I wanted to learn it was to start out with a watercolor sketch and then do gouache on top until I gradually got more confident with the material. Also doing master studies, so going to the library and getting some of those large print books of some of your heroes, especially people from the late 1800s, like your Sargent, Degas, Bert Morisot, Cassatt, and just doing small business card or credit card size sketches and just sort of figure out how they mix their colors and how they arrange their shapes is really helpful. And then also just take a photo with your phone for a while. You know, there's nothing wrong with snapping a photo. The light does change. And whatever gets you painting, you know, it's all about quantity for a long time. So take a photo and paint in your studio or finish later. Just whatever it takes to get you working is really all you need, because it's sort of quantity over quality for a long time until you get more confident with brush strokes. It usually takes me about an hour to do a painting, an hour and a half, maybe more. I like to not care that much about it, but usually after an hour the scene has changed completely, so I like to stick to an hour so that I focus on just the major shapes. Let's see. I always have a hard time choosing colors. What is your recommended limited color palette? I suppose I sort of answered this already, but I would definitely say titanium white, yellow ochre, ultramarine blue, naphthol red or a cadmium red, and then burnt sienna or burnt umber. And then of course your alternate team or your B team would be using an azo yellow or cadmium yellow, carmine for a cool red, and then also potentially ivory black. It's good to have black and white, because if you can't get into a color study, one of the better ways to learn gouache and using it by pushing it around and still getting the most out of a small sketch is to do just value studies of what you're seeing. That is a very fast way to learn converting the complexity of reality into, you know, just the basic shapes of value, the major shapes of value that you can subdivide. And the great way to do that is to use just black and white. So if you're wanting to get a lot of sketching done, forget the color for a little bit and just take some time and focus on doing small kind of credit card size sketches using black and white and focusing only on the major shapes of value and making those work. And that will take you a lot further than a lot of things when it comes to learning how to paint and travel and paint, especially with planar painting where speed is sort of the essence. Okay. I'm going to Europe and then on a cruise for 20 days. What's the least amount of stuff I need to take? I think definitely keeping just a minimal amount of tubes, and if you're an oil painter, I think you probably would prefer using crescent board cut down, because it's very similar to using a panel. I would use those things, and then you could use a board or whatever you're comfortable with. If you like working on a Pochade box, I really like these cigar boxes, and then of course Gorilla Painter makes a great Pochade box that I haven't really had a chance to use in the field a whole lot, but I've seen them and they're really nice boxes. I would, if you're not using a box that has a palette cut into it like this cigar box does that I'm using, I would recommend using just a cheap plastic watercolor palette. Mihalo makes a really good sealing palette and fusion palette. And then Masterson makes a really nice stay wet palette, especially when you're on that cruise. You could seal it, close the lid, and then keep reusing the same paint for a bunch of days in a row, where, if you're letting it dry out, you're going to end up having to toss it. But the stay wet palette's really handy for travel because you could close the lid on it and then open it back up and still have fresh paint. Also, minimal brushes. I think probably I would use whatever you use with oil, just not bristle. I'd use a synthetic soft version. So whatever you're comfortable with sort of pushing paint around. And don't forget a small cup for water and paper towels. I always forget paper towels, and then I end up using my pants leg or my shirt, and I look like a crazy person. Or trying to scramble in a restaurant for napkins. So don't forget the paper towels. That's very important. All right. And I would love to hear any tips you have about judging the color shift of gouache when you're out plein air painting. To be honest, and it could be unfair because I've been doing it a lot, so maybe my brain has sort of developed an algorithm that I'm not really conscious of, but I don't actually think about it at all, to be honest. I think because there's so much that is relative in a painting. These things are constantly changing, the scene's constantly changing, and value is relative and color is relative. When you place a color down and then another color, it changes the first color and the way we perceive that color. And it's the same with value. When you put down something that's light and then you start putting darker things, well, that thing is now not light, or it's too light. And so everything is constantly relative. The cards are really stacked against you when you're trying to paint outdoors. So you could look at that as kind of defeatist, or you could see it as kind of freeing and just allow yourself to give in to sketching and try not to control those elements. And I came from, when I was learning gouache, trying to control those elements and wanting to learn them to get better, but you just sort of have to give in and not think about it. I think it's a conversation really with nature. You can't control what it's saying back to you. You can only just put something down and then sort of roll with it and roll with the punches. And it has more to do with the way you react and converse with nature than it does trying to control those elements going into it. So just you know, learn to give in to the free fall of painting and to chase and to capture just that, like, that moment of light, that, like, flicker in time. And be willing to experiment and to push things and to see how far you can take it with the painting. And when you're pushing those boundaries, you develop a sense for how the paint's going to dry, and you'll learn and adapt as you go. So that's about all we have time for this demonstration. I went into more technical painting stuff in the full-length version. I hope I got to everybody's question. I really appreciate you watching and your continued kindness and support. I've really enjoyed getting to know everybody through this channel, and I look forward to seeing you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.